Before we get started on this week's episode, we want to tell you about a special deal for Fulhamish podcast listeners. You can get 8 incredible craft beers for just £14 with Beer 52, the UK's number one craft beer club. They ship monthly themed boxes of small batch craft beer straight to your door. And you can get £10 off your first case, which includes their award-winning magazine and snacks as well. Just use the code Fulham at beer52.com. That's the code Fulham at beer52.com. Right, on of the show.
Hello listeners, welcome to the Fulhamish podcast, the show that takes everything back 50 years, showing everything in black and white. Thank you for downloading this week's podcast as we take a look at how the Championship playoff race took another twist in Fulham's favour. My name is Jack Collins and I'll be your host for the next hour, and joining me this evening are three men who are anything but monochrome in their opinions. Farrell Monk.
Hello listeners.
Ben Jarman.
Good evening.
And Dom Betts.
All right.
Fulham travelled to the John Smith Stadium this week to take on Huddersfield Town, and boy did they have it up there, as a brace from the extra smooth Stefan Johansson led the boys to a no-nonsense first half mauling of the Terriers, taking the aggregate score for the season to 9-1 against a team who have been vying for automatic promotion. Let's start then, as ever, with some three-word reviews. Ben, would you do the honours, please?
My three-word reviews come from Spencer, Nathan and Cyril Flynn. Spencer starts with one more win. Obviously, you need one more win to get in the playoffs. Nathan Mack, three more points. And Cyril Flynn with everyone's favourite, Terriers got neutered.
That's excellent. Well done, mate.
Yeah, well done, Cyril. That's well done, Cyril. Good start. So a big win. Big win. Have we all but done enough with a performance like that, Dom?
I mean, Leeds are not on good form whatsoever. They've got 4 points out of the last 18. So, yes, I said last week you don't need to look at other people's results, and we don't, because I think we've got enough over the next two games to get enough points to make us in the playoffs. I mean, Brentford are on good form, and we'll go on to that later, but I think it's pretty much all about wrapped up now. I think Leeds are going to be so demotivated by the recent results and recent performances that they just won't have enough in them.
Fair enough. And all the Huddersfield fans saying that they really don't fancy us in the playoffs. Your take, Farrell, on Saturday's mauling?
Well, I mean, lots of pundits and pretty much loads of fans have been saying that for weeks now. No one wants to face Fulham in the playoffs. The bookies had made us favourites when we were seventh, once we beat Newcastle, which seems like an age ago considering the amount of good performances we've put in since then. And we were favourites back then, and I still think we are favourites, assuming that we get to the playoffs.
Okay, well, but we didn't have it all our own way, though, so let's get into the old meat of the game and talk about the start they had. Ben, they had us under the cosh for the first 10 minutes or so.
Yeah, they really did. They were passing it very nicely, very crisply. They kept on top of possession for a lot of it, and then eventually the pressure told, and that crossfield ball that eventually led to the penalty was nothing short of brilliant. And obviously, we're a bit susceptible to those crossfield balls, I feel. Throughout the season, it's happened to us a number of times, most notably against Nottingham Forest. But yeah, I think their opening 10 minutes was brilliant, and they had us on the back foot right from the start.
And Farrell, we bounced back from that. But Floyd's penalty giveaway, definitely a pen for me. Is there anything anyone could have done, really, about that passage of play that you thought needed more attention?
No, not in particular. Sometimes when a team scores against you, you just have to hold your hand up and go, look, fair play, well done. And I think that was one of those times. The only thing that you can kind of say is that when something like that happens, you've just got to look at your own team and sort of look for a reaction. And what a reaction.
And Dom, did you see the goal? You know, you were susceptible for
I only missed one goal. Only missed one, and it was the fourth. And I thought, I was like, no, we haven't actually just scored a goal, have we? Because I thought 3-1 at half time away to Huddersfield, who were third in the league, I think, going into the game, was a safe bet to go get a drink. Clearly not.
No, you can never write off Fulham in the 45th minute. It's something you should have learned of all people by this point of the season, Dom.
If you ever see Dom getting up for his half-time pint, you know there's a goal coming.
Yeah, exactly. In fact, can you leave at all the games with 2 minutes to go? So once Fulham got going, we looked unplayable at times, and Cesc could and maybe should have made it 1-1 earlier. Gorgeous little bit of play from Aluko, one drag back taking two players out of the game, and then Malone actually putting in a decent ball for once. A good little passage of play.
It's just kind of a reoccurring theme, really. Aluko has been absolutely terrorising defences week in, week out. I think he's just, you know, I would give him a shout out as to being, you know, without the obvious candidates, probably our player of the season. He does the simple things well. You can't say that he does amazing skills or anything like that. He's just so direct, and he takes players on constantly, and he terrorises them, and it's this never give up attitude. Like, you know, sometimes the odd thing doesn't come off, but he's just constantly going at fullbacks, constantly taking it inside, outside. You don't know which way he's going to go. Every time, loads of times you think he's going to be losing the ball, and then all of a sudden he just finds a little bit of yard of space.
Wriggles free.
Wriggles free. That's an excellent way of putting
it. I think it was used by Jamie or Jim during at one point in the game. But the goal comes eventually from a brilliant press from Fulham, and this was very much a feature of the first half and something I suppose needs serious discussion in general. Against a team who liked to play football, we identified the weaknesses they had at centre-back and we exploited them to, you know, devastating effect at times.
Yeah, I think we were talking about the press for quite a while, and we also talk about teams' ability to play through that press, and I think we basically understood that Huddersfield can't play through that press because their centre backs aren't as good as distributing the ball as ours are. I mean, we'll go on to talk about Tim Ream's pass completion rate later on in the podcast, hopefully. But you can see from his stats that he's really, really assured when playing out the back, and Huddersfield didn't look anywhere near as assured as we do playing through those first and middle thirds of the pitch. And our first goal, and then again for the fourth, basically underlined that fact in as clear an example as you want.
There was, I think one thing that, to point out is that not only was the high press worked really, really well against their centre-backs, but we also stifled the amount of options that the centre-backs had on the ball. I think one thing that we do really, really well and shows our sort of pass completion rate, that every time a defender or even any one of the players on the pitch has the ball, there is at least two or three options for them. Whereas Huddersfield on Saturday, Jonathan Hogg, every time he looked up, he was like, I got nowhere to go apart from back to my goalkeeper or lump it long. And the times that he did try to play it short, he was punished.
Well, the first goal, it came from that press, but involved a little bit of magic and a little bit of luck. Aluko's touch is dynamite, Dom, but the little flick through from Aite to Malone is not intentional, shall we say.
Yeah, but it just makes it look nicer when it's like unintentional. I don't want to score these perfect goals every single
no
week.
No look pass.
No, I do. I love a bit of shithousery, and especially at Huddersfield because we're very good at doing it there. But no, it was a great bit of play, and I think Malone, although I'm not his biggest fan, he did have a very good game on Saturday.
Yeah, he's really stepped it up in the past couple of weeks, hasn't he?
He has. He's been playing
Malone standards.
I'm a fan of a Malone moan or a Mamone. Eh?
Never ever say that ever again.
You need to be relieved of your duty, son.
But he was very, very good. Only one or two wayward crosses.
Yeah, that's usually a good game for him as well.
Yeah, that was in the first 10 minutes as well.
Well, the second goal, the penalty, is actually a good quite kick out from Bettinelli, which makes a change. And although it actually comes from a slight defensive error, he has picked out a red shirt there, and Aite does the rest on his own, and Ben is your man. You run us through it.
Well, the only thing you can expect from Aite is that he's going to drive at defenders and put them on the back foot at all opportunities, and he's done that again this week, and it's paid off dividends for us. I agree, the penalty was slightly dubious. I think the ball gets stuck in his feet a little bit, but the really clever thing about it is that when he gets into the box, you can see him looking down at his feet because he knows he's in there, and as soon as he gets touched, he's gone to ground. Some would say clever, some would say snidey, but it's Floyd, so very clever from my point of view.
I think the penalties are both penalties, if you look at them, and they're very, not similar in terms of their challenges, but the amount of contact that's required for a man to go down are similar in both cases, and I haven't seen too many complaints from either set of fans that either penalty was a penalty. Jamie and Jim said they were both soft, but they were both penalties, and the ref got called out on the highlights on 5 for making 2 correct decisions, so that's good. Good from TC to put it in the same spot. If we get another one, does he have to change that, Dom?
No. Just put it in the same spot, we'll go in.
Well, you know, when you go back to like expert penalty takers, I'm not saying that Fulham are expert penalty takers now.
Well, the stats were suggesting
I think there'd be someone that would disagree with you on that.
Yeah, but some of the best penalty takers, they put it in the same spot every single time. Like
Leighton Baines,
Ruud van Nistelrooy, he used to put it in the same spot week in, week out, and keepers would dive the right way, couldn't get anywhere close to it.
I'm going to play devil's advocate for a second. Is it a good penalty? I think if the keeper goes the right way, he keeps it out.
Well, the expert at taking crap penalties and scoring was Clint Dempsey, I thought.
Yeah, he loved it. Okay, from slightly dubious penalties to the third goal, which arguably is as good as any we've scored all season, in my opinion. It starts with brilliant defending from Malone, which is a shock to all of us. But he actually doesn't rush his clearance and finds Aluko, who beats 2 defenders on the touchline doing his little wriggle. Finds Kearney. Kearney passes, waits for Sess to catch up. The rebound falls to Johansson and he buries it. Is there anything wrong with that goal?
So I was watching the Football on Five highlights on whenever it was, and I've been pretty much watching every single highlights available. And Chris Oluwumo picked up on it brilliantly for every single sort of highlight that he showed. And not just on that time, every single time we got near the box, we put bodies in there. And I think it's just no accident that loads of times when there was a deflected shot, it was picked up by a Fulham player because we were packing men in the box trying to pick up on those things.
I think the most impressive point is that something you've touched on in the main body of the question is our ability to play out through the first third and then through the middle and then into the third really comfortably. And like nothing should be taken away from how well Aluko does with his body to sort of sell the defender one way and turn the other, and then that burst of speed past those people that are trying to cover him is absolutely magnificent. And you only see that from someone that's got really, like, obviously magnificent touch and skill. So to see him wriggle out of that, and then our use of the ball afterwards is absolutely fantastic to see. It's something that we've become used to over the course of this playoff season, is that when we get into those attacking areas, we don't panic. We're very calm, we're very collective, and as you said in the main body, we wait for players to come in, and therefore creating an overload, and therefore off the back of that developing a chance for us to shoot, and then inevitably that is either going to end in a shot on target or a goal, which is why we are the highest scorers in the league, and which is why we are so potent and to be feared by any team going forward.
It's taken a little while to get there, I would say. The first few months we were creating a hell of a lot of chances without scoring, and I used to bang on about it quite a lot. Why don't we punish teams more? Why don't we punish teams more? We're creating all these chances and we'd only score one or two a game when we should be scoring four or five, which is now what we're doing.
There's a brilliant moment in that thing when Kearney gets the ball on the edge of the box and Fredericks makes an absolute burst down the right to free up the kind of second that Kearney needs to hold the ball up for Cesc to shoot. And it was excellent at points from Fredericks, but arguably he then maybe should have been sent off after that little passage of play when he brings down Van der Parra on a booking quite cynically on the edge of the old box. And that's two games in a row where there's been questions about Ryan Fredericks being sent off. Is his kind of attitude or his kind of recklessness in a way, could that be a problem at some point?
You can argue that, but you can argue that with any of these aggressive or too aggressive players in football, and I think you've got to take them in the team. I mean, luckily we do have a good replacement in Dennis Odoi, who he's not a bad replacement to have at right back, but I think it's, although he does have this nasty streak in him, I don't think it's really an issue we need to be worrying about.
Yeah, I feel like that he controls his aggression mostly quite well.
Yeah.
It's only one or two times of the season that you really start to consider him as a threat to having like a full status on the pitch. So I just feel like only against QPR did we see it, and we saw it as vividly as we've seen it all season in the fact that he completely lost his rag. But for the most part, he can channel his aggression quite well into sort of those long bursting runs down the right, or, you know, a pretty firm tackle. He's come on leaps and bounds, both in terms of his attacking and defending. And attacking-wise, providing six or seven assists this season for us already, he's really matured and should be, praised
commended
for his role this season.
Yeah, definitely. Well, at 3-1, the game is not in the balance, but it could have gone either way to a point. And there were two points where it maybe could have been 3-2. And the first is denied with a little bit of brilliance, and the second is denied with a bit of luck. So first, a brilliant tackle from Callas denies Quainer after a good ball across from Lolly, and great anticipation from Thomas Callas to get inside the striker. And since we criticised him for a couple of rash decisions at Derby and Blackburn, he seems to have really got his head back in the right place, and some really commanding performances from centre-back.
So his performances against Norwich, and then again against Villa, and then for the third game in a row against Huddersfield, three massive games for us, and he's really led from centre-back there. His performance against Norwich was absolutely fantastic, especially in the air. And you look at the amount of crosses that he himself cleared from Norwich, really snuffing out a lot of their attacks with his anticipation as well. He seems to be a completely changed character from that sort of rash and young-looking centre-back that we saw in the games coming up to these three that I've just referenced. Before then, he really looked like he was a young head in a team that was destined to not fulfil their potential. Now everything seems to be clicking and he's at the heart of it again. And I thought that tackle was absolutely brilliant. His sense of anticipation to understand where the striker was going to be and where that ball was going to end up was something you see from a seasoned defender.
Yeah.
Dom, I know you're a big Kevin McDonald fan, and K-Mac had another, you know, decent game in front, but made two errors and both could have led to goals for Huddersfield. The first of which is him completely losing Philip Billing at the corner, and who glanced ahead at just wide. We still sometimes fall asleep at set pieces, which is slightly worrying.
Yeah, it is worrying, but it's sort of, although it's got nothing to do with the way we play, I think it's just something that comes with the way we play. We're always looking to get back forward up the pitch, and sometimes we have these lapsing concentration from a corner or a free kick because we're thinking, oh, if we get the ball back, what's the next phase of play to get on a counter attack? And sometimes that is a really bad thing, but majority of the time I'd argue that that is a good thing, because there's times where we've just been unbelievable on a counter attack. There was a time in, I think it was the first half, where Aluka got the ball and he sort of turned around about three players and was running through on goal. So it's something to look at, but I don't think it's something to look at that's got that much of an issue.
I was going to say that we over the past year and a half, 2 years, we've been really, really susceptible at set pieces, and a better team who recognises that would exploit that. And that almost did happen home to Villa the other last Monday. Even when they were down to 10 men, they had a succession of set pieces where they really, really challenged us just before they... Actually, it was in the first half that happened.
In the first half, yeah.
Yeah, and it was a clear... And it wasn't the fact that they were dominating possession, but they had one set-piece opportunity, and they just kept... It kept on going back in because they dominated us. And I think Steve Bruce must have picked up on that we are susceptible at set-pieces, and probably the reason why he went for three big centre-backs. But what really annoyed me about that set-piece was actually the one that almost led to the goal, was it should never have been a corner. Because Callas makes an exceptional tackle, but was completely taken out by Quaynor.
You can say that the ball had probably already gone and it wasn't going to change the course of... You know, he gets clipped, but I don't think... Also, if the striker doesn't challenge there...
Yeah, I know, but it's still a foul.
Well, there is a couple of things. In terms of that Aston Villa game, just to play devil's advocate again for a second, is that because we did actually eventually keep those out, and, you know, actually we do look susceptible, agreed, but we haven't conceded that as many from corners this year. Is this us maybe thinking that we're not that good at set pieces, but actually we've probably conceded, you know, the same as pretty much anyone else?
Well, even before that, in the Norwich game, they must have had about six or seven corners in a row, probably midway through the second half, when they were really starting to put on the pressure just after Cameron Jerome came on. And we looked really, really assured at defending those set pieces. And at no point do you sit there and worry about a goal going in, because you know that Callas and Ream are more likely going to have it covered. Mm. And even then, you've got K-Mac, who adds a little bit of height. And Betts has been really, really good at coming in and commanding his area, where I think that's one of the downfalls of David Button, is that he's not very good at doing that. And if he does, you can't guarantee that he's going to keep it in his hands for as long as he needs to.
Fair enough. Well, the fourth goal is that pressing game again. Aluko charges the keeper. Kearney pressurises the centre-half, and his pass to Hogg is a hospital pass. But Steph Joe with a lovely nick and a lovely finish.
Man, that finish is just sumptuous, isn't it? Mm. It just sends the keeper down so early and then just dinks it over him. Just so cool, calm and collected. And another absolutely tremendous performance from Steph Joe in the middle there. He's come up massive these last few games as well. Him and Kearney in the middle have been a great partnership throughout the season, but these last three or four games have really taken off together, and that shows the level of understanding they both have.
I love how interchangeable they are. Mm. How, you know, they know each other what they're going to do. Like, Kearney does come back and pick the ball up at the centre-backs, but it's not always him, and I think it's just them two sort of knowing that, right, he's going back to get to the centre-backs, I'm going to open up a bit of space 20 yards further up the pitch. Mm-hmm. And it just shows that they always, even though they don't always see where they are, they've got that awareness that they always know where they need to be, because they know where Steph Joe knows where top TC is, and TC knows where Steph Joe is.
Yeah, and let's not forget, obviously, K-Mac in that trio there. Mm-hmm. In midfield, because... Like, K-Mac is very, very understated, and the role he plays when he drops back between the centre-backs to make that back three allows our full-backs to go on, but then it also allows TC or Steph Joe to come back and collect that ball. And I like the fact that when TC drops back to collect it, Steph Joe's there with his energy making the space for him, either to run into or either to pick out a pass for one of our front four. And that part of the system just works absolutely magnificently. And if you look at their average position map, that they're almost always in that same midfield triangle with K-Mac at the bottom of it. and 14 and 10 just making space wherever possible. I think it's really, really impressive, that middle three. And I know, Dom, that you love K-Max.
Yeah, I think you can't sort of understate how important McDonald is to how well Johansson and Kearney play, because without him, they can't play that open and that freely, because the whole sweeper role, if you watched El Clasico last night, he just literally does the Busquets role. Mm-hmm. He opens up space for, like, so Johansson could argue be in the Rakitic role. Yeah. And it's just, he's so brilliant at doing a job, but he doesn't need to do anything special really in that role. And it's not, he's not like a Kante or anything like that, where he's all over the pitch everywhere you see him. He just does his job really, really well. And I think it's sort of down to him why Johansson and Kearney have played as well as they can.
Yeah, he just completely takes the pressure off them. He just relieves all their duties that they need to do. All they have to think about is, how can we open up a space? How can we score a goal? How can we create an opportunity for the front four? Because they know K-Mac's going to be there at the right place where we want him and when we need him, because he's that good at reading the game.
I would love to see a map of where he makes tackles around the pitch, because he seems to always seem to be in the dropping zone where the ball's going to be, where it's coming out for like a quick free, a quick counter-attack from the other team. He seems to always be, if it's going down one channel, he's there. If it's going down the other channel, he's there. He always seems to be in the right place at the right time.
Yeah, definitely. So moving into the old second half, and some might say it was a bit of a damp squib, but there were chances, and the first of those big chances came for Huddersfield. In fact, Van der Parra gets a great chance from the second of those K-Mac mistakes, although Aaron Moy does do well.
Yeah, I mean, I sort of mind-marked Aaron Moy as their key player, and I think we did well for most of the game to shut him out, especially like his effectiveness anyway. He made some good passes down, but he never made any critical key passes, and I think it's down to, again, how well our midfield play, because we did that to Shelvey in the Newcastle game. So Slavisa clearly, or maybe one of the other coaches, has sort of just tried to get their critical or make some tick in their midfield just out of the game, and I think we did that wonderfully well. I know they did have chances, but I think we just limited Aaron Moy so well.
Yeah, definitely.
We're really, really good at covering up those sort of quarterback style midfielders, the ones that just sit there in that deep base and try and look for passes and long balls over the top. We're really good at shutting those sort of players down. And it actually wasn't until Moy was dropped slightly further back into a more withdrawn role that he really started to open us up a little bit. But that wasn't until probably 15, 20 minutes to go. And Van der Parra, actually, I quite like him as a player, but I thought that that chance he should have probably done a little bit more with it.
Yeah, definitely. I think he had a lot of space and a lot of time and probably would have been disappointed not to at least test Bettinelli on that point. The next chance, however, was ours, and our little protege probably should have killed the game off. A lovely ball from TC through the middle.
That ball is just so good. That ball plays into Sessegnon, and obviously you would expect him to score, knowing his scoring record, and I reckon if that game was at St James's Park, he probably would have banged it in the back of the net.
Yeah, and then shushed the whole crowd.
Yeah, I just sort of wanted a goal at our end where the fans were, really. That was my only issue, I mean.
A slight blemish on a good day, though.
Yeah, because it was sort of a similar position to where Johansson scores his second, really. He could have maybe sold the keeper early and things over him, but apart from that, you can't really take away from the pass from Kearney, though.
What really makes it is the timing of the run is just exceptional, and TC really just, like, it's almost telekinetic the way they sort of, he sort of plays it as soon as Sessegnon makes that run. Like, I don't, you know, it's, I can't really sort of like teach that, but Sessegnon's run is right, go. I know where I need to go and whatnot. Brilliant.
This is why last week when we talked about using this formation with Sess and Malone as like the left hand side. We really quickly touched upon, he knows how to make the run because he knows what another fullback is going to do. And like, that's so pivotal to the way he plays. He understands what a fullback does and doesn't like players of the opposition to do to him. And he completely understands when and where to do it as well. And that's one of the massive highlights about his game. Also, if you're looking for an example in the dictionary of what a slide rule pass should look like, it's that Kearney pass. That's fucking unbelievable skills.
It's a lovely, lovely ball. And there was only really one last big chance of the game, and it fell to Mr. Quanor, or Quaver, as Farrell called him last week. he gets a chance from quite a dodgy Odoi header. Dennis didn't have the best of games, really, when he came on, which is a shame because he's looked a good alternative at parts to Ryan Fredericks. But Marcus Bettinelli with a big save at a point where it could have felt a little bit edgy if he'd scored that.
That has happened in some games. Bettinelli has made some big saves at some big moments, some real, because, you know, the cynic in me kind of thinks at that time, like, as he's running through on goal, it's like, right, oh God, he's going to score this. I could be right back into it and get the crowd up again, who I must say are, as official Farrell stand for approval, probably the best home support I've seen in a long time.
Is that because we now have a relationship with them because of, you know, Leeds United untimely collapse?
Yeah, I did very much enjoy singing pretty much for half an hour, Leeds are falling apart again.
I don't think you enjoyed it as much as Dom did.
No, it's still stuck in my head, really.
Well, interestingly, Huddersfield have now conceded 53 goals this season. Fulham have scored 9 of them. That means we've scored 17% of their entire intake. That is nuts.
I remember one season in the Premier League, didn't Spurs, like Wigan had conceded something like 50-odd goals.
And Spurs scored 10 of them.
Yeah, something like that, yeah.
Well, there we are. That's a Fulham record, so there you are. I'd like to give a quick shout-out to John M. Knox, who, if you haven't seen our retweet on Twitter, said, "You can't tell me Huddersfield didn't deliberately allow Fulham to win. It was clearly match-fixing. Hashtag unsporting. Hashtag spirit of the game. Hashtag football on 5. Hashtag marching on together." So, shouts out to John for the most ridiculous point I've heard in a while, considering Huddersfield are still chasing automatic promotion until that point.
I think it's a Newsnight feature next week, isn't it?
Yeah,
match fixing.
I'm going to go and give that the Jack Collins stamp of fake news.
There's delusion and then there's that. If you look at that guy's timeline in depth, it is the most delusional world I've ever seen or like ever poked my head into, and that's just a timeline on Twitter, so God knows what the rest is like.
Shouts out John Knox, official friend of the pod. So let's go into the rest of the playoff race on John's sort of backing, and let's go with the permutations of what's happened. Wednesday with a big win against Derby, a scrappy win, and Derby had a goal disallowed in the 88th minute, and everyone got very excited for a sweet minute.
LiveScore registered it as 2-2, and then obviously we were some points clear then, and yeah, I was gutted. And they even said it on commentary as well. Oh, it's 2-0, and they were celebrating, and then realised a couple of minutes later that the goal didn't actually come to fruition.
There was a definite cheer in the away stand. Hmm.
Let's take it out for a second. There are now 3 points between 3rd and 6th. We're after Reading lost to Forest, and obviously Leeds are now 3 points behind. This means that officially, well, pretty much officially, as long as Reading get a point, they're safe. Wednesday need 2 points, Huddersfield need 2 points, and we need 3 with goal difference sort of in hand. So Reading have Wigan and Burton left to play. You can't see Reading not picking up a point from those games.
Your favourite team are firmly in the playoffs.
Yeah, it looks like it. And Reading are 3rd currently, which would unfortunately, if it stayed as was, mean a trip to the Majeski, which Dom isn't allowed to attend.
I'm not going back there for 3 times in one season. I'm going to stay in the pub and stay there.
Dom's banned from the Majeski.
No. He can turn up, go to the stand, then go for a half-time pint for a good hour and a half.
Huddersfield have Wolves, Birmingham and Cardiff left to play. Wednesday have Ipswich and us. Reading have Wigan, Burton.
No, we sort of wrote Burton off last weekend, didn't we, on the pod slightly, and then they done us a favour. So hopefully Agent Woodrow and Agent Christensen might do us another favour.
Agent Woodrow wasn't in the squad.
Wasn't.
Interestingly, for Burton Albion, so you'd imagine he might be injured or just...
rubbish.
I think he's Burton's like 3rd top scorer for the season, so I think he probably should be in there. What I was trying to say is if Norwich beat Leeds, then it's over for them pretty much. They can't, barring a mathematical miracle on the last day. But more importantly, could we finish 5th or even 4th with that kind of tight sort of run-in, you know, especially with Wednesday to play?
I predicted, and I'm not going to say it's going to joke now, because when we were doing those prediction things a couple of months ago, that we would finish 3rd. Albeit on 90 points, but but we'll skip over that. But it could actually happen. We can't get 90 points. I mean, I am an accountant, and I did try and work that out. Was it? Were we on 76 plus 6 is 90. So it is possible. But on our current form, I wouldn't rule us out finishing 3rd or 4th.
I'd rather finish 5th or 6th because I want the away leg on a midweek night.
I'm with Dom.
Well, I'm in crew the first leg weekend, so I'm hoping for a nice, easy trip to Sheffield or Huddersfield.
let's go into a little bonus feature for you lot. I made a request earlier to Harry Fremantle on Twitter to ask if I could use some statistics that he had found, and he gave me permission, so all credit to him, please. Interestingly, only Brighton have lost fewer games than us, but only Birmingham and Blackburn have drawn more.
So we were the victims of our own downfall, especially in September and January. In September, I think we drew four games and we lost one, which sort of led to us not believing that we could go as far as we have. And then obviously, on the contrary to that, we are the team that has gained the most points from losing positions so far in the league. I think we have 29, which is by far and away the biggest tally, which is something we definitely would not have seen last year or even the year before that. So what a turnaround we've had in fortunes.
There's some interesting stats about Tom Kearney here and his passing completion rates. Tom Kearney's completion rate of 92.5% is higher than any non-defender in Europe's top five leagues, with the exception of Rafinha, who has 92.6 but has only played 14 games. Which means, you know, effectively, Tom Kearney is the most accurate passer in Europe who has played the full season.
I saw something funny today after the El Clasico last night that was Barcelona or the Fulham of La Liga.
I did see that. To put that in context, Kearney's only misplaced 258 passes. Xabi Alonso's misplaced 264.
Average.
Iniesta, 269.
Average.
And again, all of these with less passes played than Kearney, and quite considerably less passes. That's a nuts statistic. Like, that's absolutely insane.
It is crazy. And we've already touched on this before on the pod earlier on in the season. The amount of passes we get through per game is higher than Barcelona. Our average possession statistics, we're third in Europe, only behind Bayern and one other who I can't quite remember right now. I think it was Reading at the time, who we must now have surpassed. So basically shows what brand of football we have. But also, if we lost Kearney, what would we do? Like, we'd be buggered. Everything goes through him quite clearly.
So those pass accuracy statistics, just to close this off, Championship's top five pass accuracy players are number one, Tom Kearney with 92.5. Number two, Tim Ream, 89.7.
My guy.
Number three, Scott Parker, 89.2. Number four, Neeskens Cabano with 88.6. And in number five is Huddersfield's Hogg, who has 87.8.
I reckon that went down after the weekend.
So that's astounding. We've got the top four players in the Championship for pass accuracy. And even if you take out Parker there, who obviously hasn't played that much this season, there are three players who've had, you know, good amounts of game time.
I mean, the backbone of our whole, well, two of them, you could say, are the backbone of the whole squad. I mean, Michael Muddle gets lauded for how much he can play out of the back, but in actual fact, it's quite clear to see that Tim Ream is a very good passer of the ball. And some of the criticism he's had over the past few weeks is maybe slightly unjust. Yeah, he may have trailed off a little bit, but now he's found himself again. And some of the passes he was playing out of the back at the weekend were very, very good. So
wasn't there a question about someone did a question about Ream, and it was an obvious criticism of him, and to the panel at the time we did say that he was on a bit of bad form, but Slavica obviously likes him because he's such a footballing centre back.
Yeah.
And he does bring so much to the team, not just defensively but in attack.
Yeah, we mentioned he's really good at playing and getting out of that first line of press.
Tom, would you go so far to agree with the people on Twitter who are calling him the white blonde Rio Ferdinand?
I wouldn't go that far, but like...
300,000 people have tweeted that.
So let's move on to these pesky bees that we have to play at the weekend. Brentford are actually on their own really good run of form, inspired somewhat by the return of King, in inverted commas, Hotter, whose goal against us from a few years back now has its own banner.
Oh my God, it's the most embarrassing thing I've ever seen.
It's as tinpot as you get, really. But he actually does have 12 goals in 17 starts now, and he's really, really playing well. And I don't know if anyone's seen his goal against QPR, second one, but it's absolutely phenomenal.
Great touch, great turn, great finish.
He's a really good footballer. How crucial is it to shut him down? How are we going to shackle him? And is Ryan Fredericks going to get sent off?
don't know, yes. is my answer.
Yeah, I mean, obviously Hotter's on the form of his life at the moment. We've seen flashes of his brilliance over the past couple of seasons against us. He does obviously raise it for us, apart from, you know, I've been speaking to a couple of Brentford mates of mine, and they've said that he is quite hot and cold. And that's not just game to game. That's kind of like in the match itself. And I was speaking to you before we started how he was pretty good earlier this season, but last season, even that 2-2 draw, he was non-existent. It was Sam Saunders that was running the show for Brentford at the time. And we got to hope that the not-so-good Hotter turns up on Saturday, because he's absolutely key to how they play. But whether they're actually going to go all out attack or try and contain us, I'm not entirely sure.
Lassie Wiebe is another player in form, Dom. Do you think Jota's the key battle, or is it going to be Wiebe versus our centre-backs?
I think you'd have to argue Jota, because you'd argue how far forward our full-backs played. There's going to be a lot of space for Jota to get in behind, although he sort of does like coming sort of in the inside forward position. So I think it's just, as long as we shut him out of the game, they don't really have that many other clinical players, but you can't look past the form Brentford are in at the moment. They're playing really, really well. I know QPR were just terrible on Saturday, but yeah, we've got to be careful in this game. I mean, out of the last three games, so Huddersfield, Brentford and Wednesday, this is the one I was worried most about.
Interestingly, Ian Holloway said the defeat to Brentford was the worst result of his career on thing, with the amount of chances that he said that QPR created. I didn't see any chances that QPR created, really, apart from Matt Smith sort of blasting a header wide. But
never seen that before.
I don't know what it is about QPR managers that decide they see a whole different game when they face the media, and they just completely lie about the performance. Mark Hughes used to do it week in, week out when he was there. They were like, QPR would get battered 4-0, and we go, I think we played really well, we create loads of chances. And I'm like, what game are you watching?
Let's go back to Brentford. The other rivals, they'd like nothing more than to do us here, wouldn't they? This is their Wembley Cup final, and
it's their World
playoff
Cup final.
Yeah, this is rolled into one, isn't it? Have we sold out yet?
Getting there.
I'm going to make a little call to arms here for anyone that hasn't, one, isn't going, but two, as in, if the seats around you, bring your nan, bring your dad, like, I don't mind, just bring anyone. Let's sell the place out, please, because I know for a fact that they've got a boat coming down, which is, particularly ridiculous in the first place, but that's how much it means to them. And, they've got a fair amount, I imagine, in the neutral end, and it's going to be, a big game. It needs to be sold out. So if we could do that, that'd be great.
Last year they brought a boat as well, but they actually almost missed kickoff because it hit low tide. So the boat docked about half an hour later than it should have done.
They also, this year, took a boat to Chelsea and they accidentally went too close to the side. So they all had to stand on one side of the boat while they poked it off. I swear on my life. They had to poke it off the cliffs.
Was it actually a tin pot boat?
Well, I mean, probably. I mean, it would be only right, wouldn't it? But yeah, a little, how do you see this one going? I'm going to go to each of you in turn. So, Ben?
I think Brentford aren't really, they're not to be sniffed at, are they? They're a very, very dangerous side. They're very, very good at holding and building possession through all parts of the pitch. Although Brentford play on a very small pitch at Griffin Park, they're very, very good at making it feel like it's massive. And they're very, very good at switching the play and playing in wide areas. And aside of Hotter and Sam Saunders, you've also got someone in there like Alan Judge, who's pretty good. Again at making space, but then also they picked up someone who's meant to have a huge amount of potential, hasn't quite fulfilled it yet. Joseph Soon, who they picked up from I believe it's PSV, who's actually rapid and is very technically gifted, but really lacks that end ball. And if him and Hotter are on the same wavelength and also blowing hot, then it could be quite a rough afternoon for our defenders. But I still have every confidence that we will get something out of this game, because we look on a completely different level.
Farrell?
Yeah, I will definitely got to agree with Ben there. It is kind of a case of the one thing that I haven't really felt since before, about 3 or 4 months ago, is I don't see Fulham turning up and not playing well, considering the big game that it is. Slavica just won't have that at all. But Brentford, since the start of the season, a lot of those guys were saying, we actually don't know which Brentford are going to turn up, and they're waiting for a bit of consistency. And now they've hit that consistency, they do seem like a real potent threat. I think behind Fulham, they've actually scored the most in the league since the turn of the year. Yeah. The one big thing for them is it's that they've got this question about whether, how do they play Wiebe, Hotter and Kanyos together, because they're three really intelligent players. Wiebe works really, really hard up top, but around him there aren't that hugely hard working, and I think that's probably their downfall slightly, because they've got three very good front three, and they want to play them week in, week out, but it obviously hasn't worked for them at the start of the season. Now it's starting to click for them, and we may be playing Brentford at probably the worst moment.
We have a consistency of doing that, don't we?
Yeah, true. At the start of the season, when we played them, it wasn't exactly at the bad, at similar situation where they were actually on pretty good form, and we totally walked all over them.
Indeed. Dom, your thoughts?
Yeah, going into their form, I've just looked over the last 15 games, they're fourth in the league on form. We're top. So you could say we should be favourites going into the game, but it's just our home record just simply hasn't been good enough this year. And that's the only issue. I mean, we're like second or whatever we are in away form, but I think we're only like 10th maybe in the home tail. But you'd like to see we turn that around for this game. It's a big game for them. It's still a big game for us, not even taking the rivalry into the situation. It's probably the biggest home game we've had in ages. And I know we've been saying that going to every single game for the last few months now, but it is that big that if we win, we basically have playoff secured, unless there's like a 13-goal swing in the goal difference, I want to say.
I'm going to put it on a plate and say that's not going to happen. I think if we take the 3 points here, it's done and dusted. And there's to consider, all we have to do is match Leeds' result. If we match Leeds' result, it doesn't really matter.
Yeah, and
what
they're
happens.
In dreadful form.
They're in dreadful form, playing a Norwich side who are actually quite good.
Yeah, I think they've picked up 4 out of the possible 18 points they could have in April, because they were like 7 or 8 points clear when they're in the playoffs, and then April happened, and you could say Kearney's last minute equaliser against them has literally battered their season.
We literally said this. We did say it somewhat in a different light, but what we said was if we battered Leeds, we could see them falling apart, and we didn't obviously batter them, but we did something that was almost equally as damaging, which was to absolutely take the wind out of their sails, and they really haven't recovered. You're right.
Yeah, you know when England conceded that last minute goal against Russia, and it looks like everyone's hope and dreams just fell apart on that pitch in Marseille. It looks exactly the same for Leeds. All of them just completely fell apart, and since then their form has been nothing short of terrible, whereas ours has been on a completely upward trajectory, aside Wolves. So yeah, I think no one really predicted them falling out, but obviously we're all glad that they have.
Well, let's move to the mailbox, and we have a number of questions from a number of people. And Farrell, are you going to start us off here?
So Jack at Jack FFC with not a really me. Imaginative name, not Jack Collins. If we beat Brentford and all but secure playoffs, should we field a weakened side against Wednesday to avoid knocks and suspensions?
Bit of Twitter debate about this one. This has garnered some responses. So shouts out to Jack for increasing our social mobility on Twitter and our reaction rate. But there are some interesting points about this. One, a lot of people are saying momentum, 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 keep the 11. There are other people saying someone's going to get hurt. And, you know, there's something to be said for the lack of knocks we've had this season, which is obviously due to the work of Marco Cesarini and the team behind the scenes, who've obviously done wonders with the players in terms of we haven't really had any particularly long-term injuries. Aite and Kalas spring out, but not particularly long-term ones. I think that there's something to be said for maybe playing, you know, the likes of Syriac and, you know, players that aren't outside the squad, but players that haven't necessarily been given a bite of the apple to break them down. And, you know, we can start a team that retains its core without necessarily putting anyone under too much pressure. And we've been changing things up all season in that regard, especially around the front four. And I think that there's definitely room for manoeuvre if we can manage to, especially if we put a couple past Brentford, touchwood, and, you know, make things difficult for Leeds in terms of if they have more goals to catch up.
Yeah, I think momentum is key going into the playoffs. I mean, you could sort of look at it, say, if you want to play a weakened team because you'd rather play the team in, let's say, third, than you play the team who finished fourth. I mean, as long as we don't get Reading in the playoffs, I'll be happy, because I've refused to play them again. But, yeah, I think you should just play a strong team against Wednesday. I don't see the point in building a weakened side. Maybe bringing, yeah, as we said, the likes of Piazon, Cabano, Adoy. But I don't really see the point in changing it. I mean, the playoffs won't be for another week. We've had a week's rest. I think just play the 11 that's playing well right now. Because everyone's going to be there. We've sold out the away end. We're not going to want to see a weakened team.
Yeah.
We're going to want to see us win.
Yeah, there are a lot of interchangeable parts. But like you say, there is a week in between the games. There's no reason for us to play a weakened side. The only thing I think of is we had a little scare with Steph Joe on Saturday in the second half where he had to come off. But it looks like he'll be fine for this week coming up. So I don't know. I personally like the idea of keeping momentum. I don't want to change too many things.
Well, I think the probably we can actually go back to something like the FA Cup as kind of a tester of what Slavica would do in that situation. He'd probably keep much the same. He might rotate a couple, but I'd imagine Slavica would want to win the game throughout, and he'd probably play a full strength 11. He might take some players off with 20 minutes to go with the game all sewn up and what's going on, because, you know, we want to be third in the league. Slavica wants to be third in the league.
Yeah, definitely.
And he'll want to play the sixth best team in the league, probably.
100%. Ben, you got the next question for us?
Yeah, I've got another question. It's from Will Trilidis. Sorry if I've absolutely butchered that surname. More likely have. The question is, if we were to miss out on promotion, would you begrudge Kearney a move to Newcastle, assuming they go up? Which it looks likely they will do now.
I think if we got the appropriate value for Tom Kearney, and I don't think it's necessarily the 30 million that's now being chucked about, but I think if we got decent cash for Kearney, yeah, he's a wonderful player, but yes, he's Premier League quality and he deserves that chance and he deserves his go. I'd love to see him take us there, you know, if it was up to me, but I wouldn't begrudge him moving away. I think it'd be nice for him if he, you know, gave it one more crack, and I don't think it's necessarily off the cards if it happened. I think if they fully gave him the captaincy this summer at the end, if Parker does retire, then I could see him giving it one more go with Fulham. I'd like to hope that's a thing, and I think he has a good relationship with the people here and he likes living in London, and all those things are, you know, positive and towards our cause. But I wouldn't begrudge him a move if he left.
I don't see why he would leave, to be honest. I mean, Brighton kept the likes of Knockhart, Wednesday kept the likes of Forestieri, so I don't see a reason why he should have to go to the Premier League. I mean, I'm not being funny to Newcastle, but he'd be too far away from Matt Smith, so I can't really see him going.
Yeah, Matt Smith get moved to Sunderland or Middlesbrough, that would be the next one.
Sunderland seems about right for Matt Smith. About this level, I reckon. Just the last question in the postbag is from Alex Bomer, obviously a long-time friend of the pod and someone we've had on in the past. His question is quite long, so I'll probably break it down into the crux of what he's asking. So basically, TC has been much more effective away from home than he has been at the Cottage. He scored nearly all of his goals have come away from home. What do we put that down to? Do we believe it's positioning, or do we believe there's another factor in play here?
There's another factor that Fulham aren't very good at home and we are good away. I think you could say that for a lot of players and the whole team, that we're just not as good as home as where we are, and you could take that down to the style of play. I think the way we counter-attack teams on the break away from home suits his style of play, and he's going to play a lot better that way anyway, because he probably sees more of the ball at home, but maybe he's trying to find a key pass into Aluko or Yite when we had Martin or whoever's playing up top, because we've played about six different combinations up there by now. But yeah, I think he's not less effective at home, he just plays a sort of a different role than he does away from home, so I don't really think he's less effective at all.
We touched on earlier the quarterback role, as you were saying, and that kind of attacking midfielder sitting in into the heart of it and looking to spray the passes. And Kearney definitely does that a little bit more at home. I think when teams shut up shop against us, he just gets a little bit frustrated, if I'm perfectly honest. And as the talisman of the team, he looks upon himself to do those kind of things. And when it comes to those kind of moments and you're looking for that moment of magic, I think, yes, while TC does bring up that moment of magic a lot of the time, he often thinks that he has to do it at different points, and that's probably why he comes deeper. And it means that Johansson takes on a more forward role, especially at home, and especially we saw against Ipswich, his sort of driving runs from deep are very much in contrast to Kearney getting the ball, you know, beating a man, looking up and finding the pass. So, yeah, I suppose he plays slightly more forwards away from home, and it probably, you know, contributes to the amount of goals he scores and assists he makes.
Yeah, I've got to agree. I didn't really have that much of an opinion. I wouldn't say that there was one right answer, but Jackie, I think you've summed it up quite well there, that at home, teams against us seem to shut up shop, and Kearney does get frustrated. We did pick it up on the first half of the season. That does happen, and he does get a bit wayward, and that's probably a little reason why that he hasn't scored as many as home as we have done away. But it could be a whole mixture of things. I don't think there's one scientific answer, but you can't necessarily say that he has been playing badly at home.
No,
it's just goals haven't fallen for him, really.
There was one question left in the bag that I thought Dom might want to answer. It was from another Dom at Piazon Passion, who says, do we have the two best left-backs in the league?
Well, I mean, going forward, yeah. I wouldn't say defensively. There's a lot better left-backs in this league who can defend. Because neither of our two left-backs can really defend that well.
If you were to sign a left-back from this league, who would you sign?
See, that's not the point I'm making.
No, but it's the question.
To answer the question, we have got, for our system, we've got the two best left-backs in the league. I just don't think the left-back quality of this league is that good anyway.
Yeah.
Quite like Chris Lowe off Huddersfield. He was quite a tasty little player.
Yeah, I'm a big fan of defenders who take penalties as well.
Yeah, the old left foot. And it's also a brilliant penalty.
Would you sign Ian Hart then right now when he's 45 years old?
Ian Hart, wonderful player.
Yeah, better defender than Scott Malone. So.
Friend of the pod. Well, that all but wraps it up for this week, apart from secretarial duties, which for the last time for a little while at least are all yours, Secretary Farrell.
Oh, I've really enjoyed it. I really, really enjoy it. But I'm not going to be applying because I don't want to upstage you. I had a few suggestions of my own, some amazing ones, if I do say so myself. But I think we'll go with Cyril, with Terriers Got Neutered.
Terriers Got Neutered it is then. Well, Sammy will be back next week, as will we, hopefully celebrating 3 points against that lot from Hounslow and a playoff place in our grasp. As always, please keep sharing and downloading the pod, introducing it to the rest of the Fulham faithful, or staying involved on any of our social media pages. Thank you as usual for your questions, they've been brilliant. Come say hello either Brentford or Wednesday, and for anyone struggling for transport, do have a look at our Twitter feed for the foolproof Doncaster solution that Sammy and I came up with for making that early kickoff. Thank you very much to Ben Jarman.
Thanks for having me on, mate. Cheers.
Thank you, Farrell Monk.
You're very welcome, Jack.
And thank you as ever to Mr. Don Betts.
It's all right.
Thank you. This has been the Fulhamish Podcast. I've been Jack Collins. See you next week. Come on, you whites.
Neuter's got terriered.
Oh. Oh, no.